Good morning. Oh, come on in. Come on in. Good to see you, Denise.
Hello.
Good to see you, Jared. How are you?
Hello.
Are you ready for our service today?
I'm always ready.
These are our liturgists. They are going to do the scripture and the call to worship. And kind of interesting sermon today. Well, part of it. I'm going to talk about the first creation story and the second creation story. You want to hear more?
Of course. Yes.
You really do? Then you won't have to stay for the service.
Yay!
No, I don't think I'll do it ahead of time.
Oh, keep us in suspense.
You know what? I hear the organ playing the prelude. Why don't you guys get ready? And we're going to start our service.
All right. That'll be great.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. See you soon.
You can take your purse.
Oh, my God. Worry about thieves at the church.
Mothers in some way. Some of us just didn't breed well in captivity, as I like to tell people. So, please join me in this morning's call to worship. Mother and God, you gave me birth in the bright morning of this world. Creator, source of every breath, you are my rain, my wind, my sun.
Mother in Christ, you took my form, offering me your food of light, grain of life and grape of love, your very body for my peace.
Mothering Spirit, nurturing one, in arms of patience hold me close, so that in faith I root and grow until I flower, until I know. And that is actually hymn number 7 of our hymnal, Mothering God, You Gave Me Birth.
Thank you.
you've been told, this is a second Sunday's Family Sunday. And so let's think about families in our prayers and in our reflection. Let's think about the changes that are taking place with our families. So let us take this time for quiet reflection. Think on your family and your extended family and how the changes that are taking place in our lives affect them and affect you. And in so doing, ask for God's protection, ask for God's grace and God's wisdom in your reflection.
Thank you.
coolness of this morning, Lord, we are aware of the changes as we go from spring to summer, the changes of seasons. In the stillness of these moments, we're also aware of the changing of our lives, for they too have their seasons. There are times of doubt and times of faith, times of weariness and times of energy, times of anxiety and times of hope. And there are times of loneliness and times of love. Help us to accept them, Lord, and know that they are all part of what it means to be human. Teach us to celebrate them as part of what it is to be your children, to be finite, to be your creatures. In all of these seasons, we praise you for our lives, for the insights that you give us, for the church that we belong to, and for Christ, whose way we are called to follow. So give us vision, a vision to see the world as yours. Give us courage to claim the world for Christ's love, and give us love to accept one another as brothers and sisters. And let the healing power of the cross be upon all of us today, all who are ill, all who are lonely, all who grieve, all who are now anxious and afraid. May the glory of the heavens be upon all of us who worship you, as we do in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And this morning's first scripture reading comes to us from the very beginning, the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verses 20 through 31, and I am reading from the Women of Faith Study Bible. And God said, "Let the water teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the sky." So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living and moving thing with which the water teems, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and increase in number, and fill the water in the seas, and let the birds increase on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals, each according to its kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kind, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground." Then God said, "I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed on it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air and all the creatures that move on the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day.
Our second reading this morning comes from the second chapter of Genesis, verses 18 through 25. I'm reading from the Revised Standard Version. "Then the Lord God said, 'It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner.' So out of the ground, the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to man to see that he would call them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. Then the man gave names to all cattle and to all the birds of the air and every animal of the field. But for man, there was no found a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman and brought her to man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman. Therefore, a man leaves his father and mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked, and they were not ashamed."
Our last reading this morning comes to us from a book of Psalms, translated by Leslie Brent. "I feel as if I could never cease praising God. Come and rejoice with me over God's goodness.
I reached out for God out of my inner conflicts, and God was there to give me strength and courage.
I wept in utter frustration over my troubles, and God was near to help and support me.
What God has done for me, God can do for you. Turn to God. God will not turn away from you. God's loving presence encompasses those who yield to God.
God is with them in the midst of their troubles and conflicts. God meets their emptiness with abundance and shores up their weakness through divine power.
Listen to me. I know of what I speak. I have learned through experience that this is the way to happiness.
God is ever alert to the cries of the children. God feels and bears with them their pains and problems.
God is near to those who suffer and reaches out to help those who are battered down by despair.
Even the children of God experience affliction, but they have a loving father, mother, who will keep them and watch over them.
The godless suffer in loneliness, without hope. The servants of God find meaning and purpose, even in the midst of their suffering and conflict."
The year is 1571, and a young mother of two children, living in Antwerp, Belgium, feels that God has called her to preach the good news of God's love. She was part of a radical reform movement called the Anabaptist. Her name was Macon Wind. She felt the need to go on the streets and preach the good news of God's love to all people. However, it was against the law for her to do so. So she was arrested and brought before the judge, and he said, "You can't do this. You need to repent, recant, and go home with your family." And she said no. And so she started to preach again the good news of God's love to everyone. And she was arrested again and put in jail for several months. And the magistrate came and said, "Look, we can let you out, but you got to go before the judge and you got to kind of humble yourself and ask for forgiveness and recant of your great sin." She said no, she wouldn't. So the judge ordered her to be burned to the stake. So she was carted off, placed in a wagon, and on the way, the judge was so afraid she'd start preaching again, he drove a tongue screw up her tongue to the upper part of her mouth, so she couldn't preach or couldn't talk. Now our sons were there watching all of this. Matthew was named one, and the other, the younger one, Adrian. They watched their mother die, burned to the stake. The younger one, Matthew, fainted, passed out, and they carried him home. Now the next day, the two sons went and dug through the ashes, found the tongue screw, kept it as a testament to her commitment, to their mother's commitment to preaching the gospel. One might say it's an instant of torture, becoming a symbol of truth. So if you think power is not afraid of truth, when you hear this story, think again. I could cite on this Mother's Day, Women's Day, thousands of such stories to illustrate the treatment of women down through the centuries, even to this day. In Mexico, in Central America, a dozen women a day are killed by their spouses or men. Okay, John, happy Mother's Day. You have any other good news for us? Well, let's ask a question. How did it come to this? Why did this have to happen? Why do women have to be treated so terribly? Well, let me give you a little background. Let me find it here. We can go to 2 Timothy. Now, even though Paul had women as deacons and helpers, even had sent out women to read his letters to other churches, and where Lydia was a helper, and even Jesus, who had Mary Magdalene, who was with him at all times, mentioned many times. She was at the cross when he died. She was at the tomb when he rose. And all that is mentioned in scriptures. But 60, 70 years later, we have Timothy. Now, Paul didn't write Timothy. Timothy was trying to maybe go along, to get along with the culture, the Roman culture. So he says that women, you better shut up. You better be quiet in church. You can't teach men. You have to be subservient to men. And you better know that. And you better dress appropriately. In another passages, it said that if you want to get to the kingdom, have babies. There are two creation stories that we read this morning to you. The second one is from Genesis. It was written perhaps about the time of King David, much earlier, incidentally, than the first creation story that we read. And it's a story about God creating man out of the dust of the ground, blew into man the breath of life, and gave Adam, good old Adam, gave him a job. Now, Adam, basically, God says in this story, I want you to name all the animals. That's your job. And as I look at this scripture and think about poor old Adam, he's lonely. And you might hear him complaining to God, I don't mind naming all these animals, but it's a lonely job. Can I get someone I can relate to? And then the author has a birth story, and only a man could write this birth story, puts poor old Adam to sleep, and while he's sleeping, he pulls the rib out and creates woman. Actually, ancient history will tell you in the Sumerian culture, they had a similar story, and they called it Woman of the Rib. So I don't know if the author knew this story or used it when he put together his story. Anyway, Adam wakes up, and Adam is thrilled. Oh my goodness, yes, you did a good thing, God. Great. So Adam is happy, he's got a helpmate, and they're put in this garden, and they're naked. Okay, nothing wrong with that. And then God says, now there's a tree here, you can eat all this stuff, but don't eat from this tree. Why shouldn't you? It's the tree of knowledge. So they're pretty careful. They stay away from it. Then the serpent comes along and actually can walk, according to this story, and says to Eve, that tree there, God says you're going to die. You're not going to die. Go ahead, give it a bite. And so she does. She doesn't die. Adam comes along and says, hey, you want a bite of this? Sure. He takes a bite. And then, interestingly enough, according to the story, they suddenly realize they're naked. Oh, what's wrong with that? And God comes along and says, what happened here? Did you eat of the tree? And Eve says, yeah. And then looks at Adam. It's not me. It's that woman you gave me. She made me do it. You might say, as the first scapegoat, Eve, of all of history. From that story, the early fathers picked up on that story, second, third centuries, on up to the present day in some churches, and that the reason we die is because of Eve's sin, or Adam's sin, as if death is a punishment for sin. I never thought of it that way. We should ask the question, maybe we sin because we don't accept the fact that we're creatures. We're born and we die. And we try to be like God. And when we do that, we create sin in the world. That's the way I tend to look at it. But anyway, the church picked up on that. And Eve, from that point on, got some pretty bad press. Let me give you some examples. Poor old Eve. It's her fault, you know. Even the Son of God had to die because of the sin of the world. And actually, it was because of Eve. She started it. And theologians and early church fathers did nothing but write incredible stuff about poor old Eve. Let me find some writings for you. Thomas Aquinas suggested that maybe God made a mistake in creating women and caused all this problem. The Catholic Council of Mary in the 6th century voted that women had souls. They weren't sure, because they didn't find that literally in understanding the creation story. So they had to vote and decide if women had souls. That was the 10th century. We can go all the way through back to the 2nd century, Clement of Alexandria. Every woman should be filled with shame by the very thought that she is a woman. Later, Church Father Tertullian emphasized that women deserve their status as despised and inferior human beings. So Eve got the rep. She's the reason everyone dies and everyone is punished for their death. For several centuries, the church practiced what they call the witch hunts. Let me read you from one person, a church father. And do you not know that you are an Eve? They said this to women who were sentenced supposedly as witches. The sentence of God on this sex of yours lives in this age. The guilt must be of necessity lived too. You are the devil's gateway. You are the unsealer of that tree. You are the first deserter of the divine law. And you are she who persuaded him who the devil did not have enough valiance and power to even attack. You destroyed so easily God's image, man, on account of your desert, that is death. Even the Son of God had to die. Whew. Aren't you ashamed, women? Because you're all Eves. That's basically. And you wonder why it took so long for women to have any place in society when the church, taking all this literally, to this very day? Here's a recent quote by a very famous modern televangelist. The feminist agenda is not about equal rights for women. It's about a socialist, anti-family political movement that encourage women to leave their husbands, kill their babies, practice witchcraft, destroy capitalism, and become lesbians. I like the first creation story. It was written later, in the 6th century, during the Babylonian captivity. Actually, it was written as a critique, you might say, of that second story, the older one. As was read, it's a beautiful story. It's a story about beauty and about orderliness out of chaos. And it is in opposition to the very popular one of the Babylonians in the time in which this was written. Theirs was a brutal one, terrible. This one is God's beauty of all creation and God's love. And what I like about it is that after each day God creates, at the end he says, "That's good." Actually, the Hebrew word should be, "It's perfect. It's complete." In other words, you can't improve on this. So each day he does that. Interestingly enough, when he gets to creating them male and female, hear this, male and female, in the image of God. Oh, not just in the image of one, and poor Eve in the older story, she wasn't in the image of God, she was in the image of man. But when he's done creating them male and female, God does not stand back and say, "It's good, it's complete." I like to think that the writer was trying to say something about himself, about the world in which he lived, and about all humankind. We're not finished yet. In other words, we are God's unfinished products. Indeed, that's what you are, and that's what I am. Someone once gave me a t-shirt that says, "Handle with care, God is not finished with me yet." Maybe we ought to think about that. Handle with care, for God is not finished with us yet. And that's my word to you today. Let us handle each other with care, for God is not finished with us at all. Amen. As said at the beginning of the service, I not only would celebrate Mother's Day, but Women's Day. Because as every man knows, all women are nurturers and nurturing. And I see God in a feminine form as well, where God too is nurturing. And it's really unfortunate that the literalist of the ancient church decided to take that second creation story as their understanding of women and men and life, rather than the first. Because as I said at the end of the short meditation, we are all God's unfinished projects. God is still working with us. God's grace is still within us, all of us, men and women. But I want to read to you a song I came across. I wish I could sing it or have it sung for you. Maybe sometime I will. It's called Supermarket Flowers. It goes like this. Apparently it's a response to a mother's death. It says, I took the supermarket flowers from the windowsill. I threw the day-old tea from the cup. Picked up the photo album Matthew had made, memories of a life that's been loved. Took the get well soon cards and stuffed them with stuffed animals away. Poured out the old ginger beer down the sink. Dad always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But Mom, there's a tear every time I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces. It's tearing me up, but I know. A heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I'll sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my mom. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. When God takes you back, we'll say hallelujah, you're home. So I fluffed the pillows, made the beds, stacked the chairs up, folded your nightgowns easily in a case, and John said he'd drive. Then put his hand on my cheek and wiped a tear from the side of my face. And I hope that I see the world as you did, because I know a life with love is a life that's been well spent. So I'll sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my mom. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. When God takes you back, he'll say, hallelujah, you're home. You were an angel in the shape of my mom. You got to see the person I have become. Spread your wings, and I know that when God took you back, he said, hallelujah, you're home. So, to all of you out there, especially to your moms, and you women, I say, may the peace of Christ be with you. And I know your response is, may the peace of Christ be with you also. I think the air conditioning just came on. Is that correct? Do you hear the noise? I don't know how to turn it off, but we'll just try to live with it until we can fix it. I hope the deacons are making calls. And you have my number, you can call me. I have called several members just to check up on you, to see how you're doing. Please do that. And I think you received the letter, and there's a note outside on the bulletin board that tells you how to get our service online. And it says get well, or be well, I think it's better to say that. And then also it reminds you that yes, our church is still paying bills and we're still operating. And so your online contributions are very helpful. I don't know when we're going to start up again, but we'll find out. But as I close, let me ask a question. When will we be safe? Good question. There have been periods in our history when that question was asked. When will we be safe? Remember the beginning of the revolution. Americans asked themselves that question. When is it going to be okay? When are we going to be safe? Safe. And other times in our history, that question was asked. When they fired on Fort Sumter and the Civil War began, we asked the question, when will we be safe? When will our nation be safe? And other times too, after 9/11, we asked that question, when will we be safe? Even before 9/11, we asked that question during the Great Depression. My parents would talk about that. They were very young, but they could still remember people standing in line just to get soup. And so I'm sure their parents asked the question, when is it going to be okay? When are we going to be safe? And then in 1918 and 1919, the terrible pandemic that we experienced, people across the country were asking that question, when are we going to be safe? So we're asking ourselves that question today. I just heard on NPR that Nebraska is beginning to be a new hotspot for the virus. And many people are so worried about getting our nation, quote, back to normal, whatever that is, that they're saying such things like, let's be young soldiers and let's get out there. And some of us are going to die, but we're going to get our nation back as it was before. I think we know that, for now, that's an illusion. I had one commentator, used to be a famous commentator, no longer has his job, but he made the comment, well, some of those people that the virus is taking, they were on their last legs anyway. Well, I'm 80 years old, and some of you are 80 years old. How are your legs? Are they okay? No, we're not on our last legs, and that's not a way to solve the problem. And some people, of course, I thought I'd put it online, but people would laugh at me. One televangelist said God told him that he needed $3 million to restart his ministry. So he got up and he cursed COVID-19 and he drove it out of the country. Be gone, he said, hollered and screamed. And that was a month ago. It hasn't disappeared. Then another televangelist said, I love these stories because they don't make sense. Another televangelist said, if America repents, God will solve our problems. I think the virus has brought out some of the best in America, the very best. So many people have risked everything to help others. And I'm tired of hearing the numbers, 70,000, maybe 80,000. But I want to think about and have us take some time to pray about is the 70 or 80,000 families that lost a loved one, a mother, a father, some children, a grandparent, and the pain that they're going through. So let's remember that. Let's think on those things. And let us continue to reach out to each other. Call your families, FaceTime, I'll tell you that every week. Touch lives as best you can. And think about ways in which maybe we can, as our church, even give more funds to the food bank. You see those lines of cars by the thousands just getting fed. It's absolutely frightening. But you also see the cheers and the claps. Some man who was survived the Holocaust. He was 90-some years old, and he survived the virus. And as they wheeled him out, everyone in the hospital staff, tears you can see from their eyes, even through the mask covering, clapping and cheering. That's the American spirit. That is the spirit of Christ. Now, not everybody can put that in theological terms or even assert it as such. But wherever there's love, wherever there are people reaching out to each other, wherever there are people self-sacrificing, that is the spirit of Christ alive. There's a song I would like to, that will be played for you. I would like to read the words. It's one of my favorite songs, and hopefully we'll have it played, and someone will sing it. It's taken from Scripture, from Isaiah. It says, be not afraid. You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live, so be not afraid. I go before you always. Come follow me, and I'll give you rest. And if you pass through raging waters in the sea, you shall not drown. If you work amid the burning flames, walk amid the burning flames, you shall not be harmed. If you stand before the powers of hell and death is at your side, know that I am with you through it all. Blessed are your poor, for the kingdom shall be theirs. Blessed are you that weep and mourn, for one day you shall laugh. And if wicked tongues insult and hate you all because of me, blessed are you, Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come and follow me, and I will give you rest. I wish you all, this coming week, the peace of Christ. Let me finish with this affirmation of faith. Let us think on this. We believe that when we're gathered together, even watching online in our homes, that the Spirit of God is present, and good things can happen, and life can still be full. We believe that we are immersed in mystery, that our lives, as difficult as they may be, are more than they seem, that we belong to each other and to a universe of great creative energies whose source and destiny is God. We believe that God is after us, that God is calling to us from the depth of human life. We believe that the nature and character of God has been revealed to us in Jesus of Nazareth. In and with Jesus, we believe that each of us is situated in the love of God, and the pattern of our life will be the pattern of Jesus' life through self-sacrifice and an ever-deepening and transforming experience of the risen Christ. And we believe that the spirit of compassion is present with us, the church, as we gather to celebrate our common existence and the fidelity of God. And we celebrate the sacredness of life lived by the power of God's Spirit revealed in Jesus. May the Spirit of Christ be with you this week. Amen.